The organizers of DICON 2021, particularly my good friend Dr. Banshee Sabu, for having allowed me the opportunity to speak to you about this very interesting topic. So now, with your permission, I will try and share my slides. I've been asked to speak about this very interesting topic, that is, are we missing our cases of monogenic diabetes? Now, before I start, I would like to state that I have no specific conflicts of interest relevant to this particular talk. So what's monogenic diabetes? Monogenic diabetes is diabetes due to defect in a single gene, a defect or a mutation in a single gene. Now, we all know that type 1 and type 2 diabetes also have a genetic component, but they are not exclusively genetic disorders. There is also a very important environmental component, more so for type 2 diabetes and type 1 diabetes, such that mutation in a single gene cannot explain the entire pathophysiology of either of these two diseases. Monogenic diabetes, on the other hand, if you have the mutation, you have the disease. If you have a specific mutation, you have a specific type of diabetes. And if you do not have the mutation, you do not have that disease. And there are four clinically important phenotypes of monogenic diabetes. The first and foremost one is a progressive form of diabetes, youth onset diabetes, with one affected parent. And these were traditionally called MODY, maturity onset diabetes of the young, 3, and MODY 1. And they are due to mutations in the transcription factors, which are very important in the development and functioning of the pancreatic beta cells. HNF1 alpha, that is hepatocyte nuclear factor 1 alpha and 4 alpha. And the second phenotype is a mild non-progressive fasting hyperglycemia. That is due to mutation in the glucokinase gene. Earlier, it was called MODY 2. Then you have neonatal diabetes, which is due to mutations in the genes encoding the inwardly rectifying potassium channel of the beta cell in the majority of cases, the KCNJ11 and the ABCC8 genes. And then we have the various syndromic forms of diabetes like Wolpert-Rallison syndrome and renal system diabetes syndrome, or MODY5. Now, how common is monogenic diabetes? Let's look at the global data. Now, monogenic diabetes accounts for around 1 to 5% of all cases of pediatric diabetes in many Western cities, most of which from Western Europe, a few from the United States. The prevalence is around 1 to 1% in Norway, much lower, 0.24% in Australia, and these are from population-based studies. The population prevalence of 0.17 per 1 lakh in the UK. And in the UK, where there have been lots of studies on monogenic diabetes, 18% of all non-type 1 diabetes appears to be monogenic diabetes. Even so, in all of these countries where there are multi-ethnic populations, it has been shown that monogenic diabetes is less common in children of Asian ancestry, which we'll come to a bit later. And this is a very large registry. It's called the SWEET registry. It's a registry of pediatric diabetes from Europe, 6 to 7 countries in Europe, as well as from South America and Brazil. And they found that in this study, we had 27,000 participants, more than 95% had type 1 diabetes. So type 1 diabetes remains the most common form of pediatric diabetes, even in this Caucasian population. Type 2 diabetes accounts for around 1.3%. And the other 3% is other forms. Of the 3% who are diagnosed with other forms of diabetes, the glucokinase monogenic diabetes, or MODY2, accounts for around 22%. And the MODY 1, 3, 4, 5, or 6, the other forms of monogenic diabetes, account for 12%. Neonatal diabetes accounts for 6%. And other unspecified forms of monogenic diabetes account for 7%. So when you look at the other forms of diabetes, other than type 1 and type 2 diabetes in a young population, the monogenic forms of diabetes appear to constitute the lion's share. In India, we have what is known as the Young Diabetes Registry. Now, this has been set up by the ICMR, and there are various coordinating centers in India. For example, in North India, we have the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, and in South, we at Madras Diabetes Research Foundation are the coordinating center. And here we have a clinic-based registry of young individuals with diabetes aged less than 25 years at onset of diabetes. And recently, the second prevalence paper from the YDR has been published. And here we find that, again, as in the Caucasian population, almost 65% of individuals, almost 2/3 of individuals, young onset diabetes have been diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. Type 2 diabetes appears much more common in our population in youth than in the Caucasian population. And monogenic diabetes, or MODY, constitutes around 3%. But you should remember that it's a very highly selected population. Now, the clinicians who are participating in the Young Diabetes Registry are people who are aware of the existence of this entity. I'm sure there are many clinicians who are treating diabetes in India who either are not aware of this entity or do not have the facilities to test for this entity. So this really cannot be said to be the population prevalence of monogenic diabetes in India. But this is a good ballpark figure to start with. So now the question arises, if you diagnose monogenic diabetes or MODY in the clinic using clinical criteria, are they really monogenic diabetes or is there any problem with the specificity and sensitivity? Now, these are the clinical criteria for the diagnosis of, at that time, it was called MODY. And these were described by Tattersall and Fahans in the year 1975. Onset below 25 years of age, autosomal dominant, multiple generations affected, no ketosis, no autoimmunity, no insulin required for at least 5 years, mainly due to impaired insulin secretion, and usually there is no obesity or insulin resistance. But the problem is that we find that these criteria are not particularly useful for diagnosing monogenic. Now we know that we cannot diagnose monogenic diabetes without genetic studies. And when we see people who have been identified as monogenic diabetes using the clinical criteria and then subject them to genetic study, we find that really not all of them are found to have any genetic defect at all. So here we have a series of 96 individuals clinically diagnosed with monogenic diabetes or MODY who were sequenced for the common HNF1-alpha and HNF4-alpha genes. And we found that only 9 out of 96 had the HNF1-alpha. And this is supposed to be the most common form of monogenic diabetes in the clinic population. And 3 had HNF4-alpha mutation. So only around 12% of this population who were highly selected using clinical criteria were found to have monogenic diabetes by the genetic test. So the criteria are not particularly specific for picking up monogenic diabetes. The same experience was found in CMC Vellore also. They did the same thing. 80 individuals with young onset diabetes fulfilling the clinical criteria, and they were only able to find causative mutations in 11 out of 56 clinically diagnosed monogenic diabetes subjects. It's around 19%. So what does that imply? Why do clinical criteria perform so poorly? It might be that the prevalence of monogenic diabetes may be truly low. It is a genetic disorder. It varies between populations. It might be that in Asian Indian population, the prevalence is really low. Or it could be that because of the high prevalence of young onset type 2 diabetes in our country, in the Asian Indian population, the clinical criteria may not be sensitive or specific enough to differentiate monogenic diabetes from type 2 diabetes. So that could be another reason. And that is the reason which was given by Dr. Hattersley's group. They have a MODY risk calculator to find out which among the young individuals with diabetes would benefit from genetic testing. And they find that the risk calculator performs really well in individuals of European ethnicity. It performs really badly in individuals of South Asian ethnicity. And the reason given for that is that the prevalence of type 2 diabetes is very high in Asian Indian youth. So the criteria are not designed to differentiate between monogenic diabetes and early onset type 2 diabetes. And this is the reason. You see the differences between monogenic diabetes and type 2 diabetes. Both are genetic. You can say that in monogenic diabetes, only one parent will be affected. In type 2 diabetes at the young age, both parents will be affected. But in our country, diabetes is so common that even in individuals with monogenic diabetes, you might get a situation where diabetes is present in both the sides of the family. And that's not monogenic diabetes in the family, it's type 2 diabetes in the family. Obesity and occurrence of snaggery cancer are said to be uncommon in monogenic diabetes. But remember, the population prevalence of obesity is increasing. So more and more, you will get obese individuals being diagnosed with monogenic diabetes. Even some of them may have acanthosis also. And of course, therapeutic response, you'll only know once you start treatment. But it really doesn't matter from a practical point of view if you mistake somebody with monogenic diabetes as having type 2 diabetes. Because ultimately, at least in India, they will end up getting same treatment. So the treatment for monogenic diabetes, MODY 1 and MODY 3, is sulfonylurea. In India, if you start metformin, it doesn't work. The next drug we give in the vast majority of cases is sulfonylurea. So these individuals will end up getting the right treatment by default. Also, the risk of complication is similar between monogenic diabetes and type 2 diabetes, and it only depends on the control of diabetes. So if you get them under good control, it really doesn't matter what treatment you give, they will do quite well. We should be more concerned in differentiating type 1 diabetes from monogenic diabetes. And for this purpose, the criteria serve us quite well. Because usually in type 1 diabetes, there will not be any family history of diabetes. C-peptide and autoantibodies. These two are the most specific tests for differentiating the two. In fact, we would even say that if you have detectable C-peptide 5 years after onset of diabetes, and if you do not have pancreatic autoantibodies, then you should reconsider your diagnosis of type 1 diabetes because there are implications. Type 1 diabetes needs lifelong insulin. Monogenic diabetes, MODY1 and MODY3, which are the most common in the clinic, will respond to low-dose sulfonylurea. They will not get diabetic ketose doses in their life. And you have to make the diagnosis early because earlier you make the switch from insulin to sulfonylurea, the better will be the response, the better will be the outcome. Now let's switch track and talk about neonatal diabetes. This is a form of diabetes which has onset in the first year of life. And at this particular age, type 1 diabetes is extremely rare. In fact, Dr. Hattersley says that it is unknown below 1 year of age, type 1 diabetes. So anyone having diabetes below 1 year of age, onset below 1 year of age, whatever be the current age, has to be evaluated for genetic disorders. And some of these, a good proportion of them, have mutations involving the inwardly rectifying potassium channel or KATP channel. The two genes involved are the ABCC8 and the KCNJ11, each of which encode a particular subunit of this particular potassium channel. And the clinical implication here is that these children, even though they are insulin dependent, they respond very well to sulfonylurea. Only thing, you may need a slightly higher dose. Early initiation also very important in this case because many of these children also have neurological deficits. It's called the Dent syndrome. And the earlier you start sulfonylurea, the better it is for the child as far as CNS is concerned. But the point is that you should not make this decision of changing from insulin to sulfonylurea unless and until you have the result of a genetic test. But there are forms of neonatal diabetes which do not respond to sulfonylurea. In those cases, you go and stop the insulin, you may get into trouble. And this is the effect of switching from insulin to sulfonylurea in children who have mutations in KCNJ11 and ABCC8. You can see the drastic reduction in HbA1c, 14 to 7, 16 to 6, 11 to 7. Remember, all these children were on insulin. On insulin, they had HbA1c of 16.6. On sulfonylurea, they have dropped down to 6. And the other interesting point is that the response to sulfonylurea is durable. You can see here patients with the KCNJ11 mutation followed up over a period of 4 years. You can see that the sulfonylurea seems to be working as well as in the beginning, which is in contrast to patients with type 2 diabetes in whom the durability of sulfonylurea is questionable. And we have data from Europe and the UK that up to 11, 12 years, these children are able to maintain their glucose levels with sulfonylurea. The same thing in patients with ABCC variation. We have a follow-up for up to 4 years. Glucokinase defects, I won't go into detail because we hardly see them in our clinic. Here they have, because of defect in glucose sensing, they have isolated elevation of fasting glucose. And they do not need treatment and neither do they respond to treatment. And HbA1c will be in the range of 7.5 to 8. They do not have any risk of complications. Unless and until the patient is a pregnant woman, we do not need to treat them. And if you find anyone with GCK mutations being treated, you can attempt to stop the treatment. Nothing will happen to their glycemic control. So who should undergo genetic test? Genetic testing is not easily available, neither it is cheap. So just by going by clinical criteria, if you start screening, number one, you screen a lot of people who don't have monogenic diabetes, and you end up missing people who do have monogenic diabetes. They are neither sensitive nor specific. Ideally, in a perfect world, everybody with youth onset diabetes should undergo genetic testing. But we know even in Western countries where the money is not an issue, this cannot be done. So because it is not cost effective and has a low yield. Therefore, we have to go by phenotype based approach. That is where our clinical skill comes in. We think looking at the patient that this patient is more likely to have an atypical form of diabetes. So then we do targeted testing. So somebody with type 1 diabetes who just doesn't look like type 1 diabetes, family history is there. Most important history, another member of the same family having young onset diabetes and being managed with tablets. Then your alarm bells will start ringing. It is not a type 1 diabetes you are dealing with. You are dealing with some other form of diabetes. People with mild fasting hyperglycemia who do not have a significant increment after a glucose load. That is GCK mutation. You can stop treatment. And neonatal diabetes, any child who is found to have diabetes in the first year of life should undergo genetic test. This is one situation where it is mandatory. we have this registry of monogenic diabetes in our center, in which if anyone is interested in sending samples or sending data or getting any further information, you can log into this website and we will be happy to give you all the details. So I'd like to conclude by saying that monogenic diabetes is likely underdiagnosed, and we don't have to be sorry about that, because that's the case everywhere in the world. I don't think any country in the world can say that they have diagnosed all the cases of monogenic diabetes. Clinical criteria are not sensitive or specific, because they were actually propounded in an earlier time and age, when young onset type 2 diabetes was not so common. Universal testing, although ideal, is impractical. So we need to do targeted testing. You have to find the patients who are most likely to benefit from a diagnosis. That way you can conserve scarce resources and make sure that the testing is given only to people who will benefit maximally from it. I thank you for your attention, and questions you are going to take now or at the end?
Thank you.